So welcome to HOMT 614 Hospitality and Tourism Strategy. This is our fifth session, and in today's session, we will be looking at the internal analysis. We are still on that, as it has to do with strategic analysis being the first level of the strategic process. And today, we will be looking at the human resource context. We will be discussing the nature of the human resource context in the hospitality and tourism industry, and focusing mainly on the aspects of the human resource context that strategic management needs to focus on if they are to create a sustainable competitive advantage for their firms in the context. So as usual, there are certain learning outcomes we hope to achieve by the end of this session. The first one is to be able to define and explain the importance of human resources to tourism and hospitality organizations. The second one is to be able to explain the employment and working conditions in tourism and hospitality organizations. And then finally, to be able to explain the importance of the guest employee encounter to tourism and hospitality organizations. So these are the three main objectives we hope to achieve once the session is concluded. So let's begin, starting from the importance of human resource in hospitality and tourism, henceforth referred to as HNT. So the hospitality and tourism sector, as we all know, is labor intensive because it is primarily a service sector. And therefore, the core of service delivery in that particular context will require a lot of human intervention. So when it comes to developing a competitive advantage in this particular sector, it is fit to say that the human element is one of the key differentiators between firms, which can lead to the creation and development of a sustainable competitive advantage. And for that reason, human resources or employees are referred to as one of the critical success factors in this sector, given the nature of the sector as a service-intensive sector. And the nature of the sector being significantly labor intensive, given the fact that it is predominantly about service delivery. Good. So still on the issue of the importance of human resources in HNT, it is also important to note that the human factor, given that it is a service intensive sector that requires the human element to create and deliver these services, requires for the sector to focus on certain critical aspects, assuming that they are trying to use human resource as a basis for developing a sustainable competitive advantage. And these include service quality, where we are talking about the perceptions of the customers regarding the nature and quality of services that they receive, and whether or not these services that they receive exceed or meet their expectations. Now, in the event that the quality of the service received meets their expectations, we say that the customer has been satisfied. In the event that it does not meet their expectation, we say that the customer has been dissatisfied. And in the event that the service quality that is delivered meets and exceeds their expectations, we say that the customer has been delighted. Hence, when it comes to the human element in the hospitality and tourism sector, we do not just consider service quality, but we also consider the level of customer satisfaction that is created as a result of the quality of service that is delivered. And ultimately, if the quality of service that is delivered manages to result in a satisfied and delighted customer, the tendency of this customer to remain loyal to that particular service provider in the HNT sector is high. So once again, the human factor in delivering these services and the quality at which these services are delivered go a long way to predict the level of customer satisfaction, as well as the subsequent levels of loyalty that they exhibit towards the firms in this sector. And if a firm is able to master the art of delivering service quality, leading to satisfied customers that will remain loyal, the firm can be able to leverage on these to develop a competitive advantage for themselves and improve upon the organizational performance. And this is according to Kuslovan et al. 2010. So It is important for us to look at the issue of the human element in service delivery in the hospitality and tourism sector, given all the unique and important contributions that this particular element makes to overall success in terms of superior organizational performance and a sustainable competitive advantage in the hospitality and tourism sector. But why is it important for us to look closely at the human resource component in this sector? There are a number of reasons. The first one being that most of the services that are delivered in the hospitality and tourism sector are reliant on customers' interactive experiences with employees in this sector. So by virtue of this interaction, we need to pay close attention to the human resources that are involved in these interactions, because customers create their experiences and measure these experiences against their expectations based on how these interactive experiences turn out. So you realize that a customer would usually go to a particular firm in the hospitality and tourism sector, be it a hotel or a travel agency, with prior expectations that are based upon perhaps their own research or previous knowledge that they have as a result of consuming similar services, or word of mouth that they have obtained from friends and family about the nature of such experiences or interactions and what they should expect to gain out of such interactions. So the human resource element that is involved in these interactive experiences go a long way to determine whether or not what expectations these customers had going into these interactive experiences will be met or not. That is why it is important for us to pay close attention. Another reason why it is important for us to pay close attention to human resources in H&T is that most of these interactive experiences involve frontline staff. And these frontline staff are usually those at the lower level of decision making in the organization, right? We talked about the organizational hierarchy, where we refer to the strategic level, the tactical level, and the operational level. So these frontline staff are usually at the operational level. But the key thing here that we need to bear in mind is the fact that these frontline staff are generally of the lowest status in the organization. So that means that they do not influence decision making to a large extent and may not have as much experience and exposure as other employees on higher levels of the organizational hierarchy, which they can bring to their interactions with customers. At the same time, these frontline staff are also the least highly trained. So it goes back to what I just said regarding the ability to bring the knowledge and the experiences that they have gained to the customer interaction. Because whereas employees at higher levels of the organization have various forms of training and education over several years with experience under their belts, these frontline staff are often the least experienced and the least trained. So that way, their interactions with customers will always pose some kind of threat to the organization if the organization is not able to take control of these interactions and influence these interactions to the extent that they can guarantee that these interactions between frontline staff and customers yield positive outcomes. And most of the time, we realize that because these frontline staff are also the least paid, they are sometimes the least motivated to bring their best to these interactive customer experiences. So all these characteristics of the frontline staff, which they bring to the customer's interactions with the organization, because in this case, the frontline staff, even though they are interacting with the customers as individuals, are interacting with the customers in the name of the organization that they work for. And therefore, it is the responsibility of the management of the organization at the strategic and operational level, at the strategic and tactical level, to ensure that these frontline staff, with all these characteristics that would often be detrimental to the customer interactions that they have on a daily basis are somewhat curbed, right? And that is why it is important as part of strategy in the hospitality and tourism sector to look closely at the human resource factor, given that it can pose significant threats to the ability of the organization in question to develop a sustained competitive advantage as well as achieve superior organizational performance, right? So with regard to the importance of the human resource, as we have said, paying close attention to the frontline staff is very, very important. Even though they are not the only employees in the organization, they are the first point of call through which customers interact with the organization. So the ability of the firm to build successful interactions will to a large extent predict how well customers' subsequent experiences with other employees or staff of the organization will go. And these will together determine how well the firm is able to achieve its objective of getting superior performance and having a sustainable competitive advantage. So firms must, as a matter of importance, make sure that they formulate and implement strategies that are targeted at improving the human resource component of the organization, to be able to ensure that on a consistent basis, these human resources are given off what they need to in order to ensure that service delivery at various touch points in the organization is delivered at a superior level. Because without an adequate strategy to monitor how the human resource is deployed and how their interactions with customers proceed, the firm will not be able to ensure that what benefits they could get from these employee-customer interactions are maximized. So it is important for firms in the H&T sector to formulate specific strategies that have to do with the human resource element and implement these strategies to be able to ensure that their objectives are subsequently achieved. So now that we have understood the importance of the human resource component in the hospitality and tourism sector, let's talk about employment and working conditions in the hospitality and tourism sector. Now, when you consider the H&T sector, including events the world over, you realize that they employ a sizable number of employable people all over the world, right? And literature has it that it is likely that these three sectors, being the hospitality, tourism, and event sector, employs more than the automotive industry, which is known to employ quite a number of people, but slightly less than education, right? And given the nature of the sector, employment opportunities continue to increase. Now, this has been stalled a bit as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. However, with the COVID-19 pandemic has come new business models in this sector, some of which are contributing significantly to increasing the number of employment opportunities that are available. For instance, currently, thanks to Airbnb, a lot of previously unemployed people now have employment, as long as they own property that is rentable, that visitors could rent and use for short stays or extended periods of stay. So like I said, even though COVID-19 has slowed down the industry a bit, there are new business models that are emerging in the industry in response to the COVID-19 pandemic, which continue to create new employment opportunities for individuals in this sector. So in essence, this sector employs a huge number of people and continues to employ even more people in our current dispensation. So according to the World Travel and Tourism Council, it is estimated that the wider impacts of this industry are taken into account in terms of the supply chain, investments, as well as consumer spending. And these together are estimated to support almost 255 million jobs. Now, currently, there are about 6 billion people in the world. So if one sector is employing about 255 million people. It tells you the sheer size of the sector and the impact of the human resource in this particular sector, given the number of jobs that it has created. So in terms of employment and working conditions in the HNT sector, firms that are operating in the sector need to be mindful of how to be able to go about effectively managing this huge number of employees and ensuring that each of them is at a level that they are well equipped to deliver superior customer experiences. Because in the tourism and hospitality sector, it's all about being able to create a unique experience that will give the customer a memorable impression, which will lead them to return and give positive word of mouth, as well as advocate for the brand to others. So in terms of employment and working conditions, it is not only the size of the workforce, which is about 255 million jobs, but also about the distinctive composition of this workforce. Remember when we're talking about the importance, we talked about the fact that the frontline employees are the first point of call. However, there are other employees also who work both in the front end and the back end in the hospitality and tourism sector, all of whom play a unique role to be able to ensure that business as usual goes off daily in the sector without a hitch, right? So the human resources that make up the workforce in this sector are often characterized by a number of criteria, right? The first criteria being that most of them are females. So in terms of gender, when we are comparing the number of male employees to the number of females in the sector, we realize that a lot of them are female. Kwame, can you attest to this? Do you have more female employees than male employees on your end?
Immediate example is us. We are not even employees, but just to yes. Let me allude to that.
Yeah.
But an example is what we are doing now. The second week, the class we define ourselves.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right. So it's predominantly female, and then you also see that a large proportion of them are usually young people, most of whom are at the operational and some at the tactical levels, right? A large number of them are also part-time and seasonal workers. And we see this a lot in the more developed world where during summer breaks and holidays, students actually go into the hospitality and tourism sector to look for jobs. This sector, however, apart from all this, is also characterized by high staff turnover rates. People quit their jobs a lot in this sector. And because of that, firms in this sector face significant recruitment difficulties. Because if you have a lot of people leaving, you always have the challenge of finding suitable replacements for these people that are leaving on a consistent basis. And imagine every now and then having to look for a qualified person to fill a position that someone else has left. And I know in Ghana, yes, some years back, we realized something based on anecdotal evidence that the high turnover in this sector is not because employees are leaving the sector, but they usually leave one competitor and they go and work for another competitor. So you go to this particular hospitality institution and you see them there, and then a few months later or a few years later, they are no longer there. They are in a competitor's institution. Still, in the hospitality and tourism sector, we can also see poor levels of training. And this one, I remember Kwame attested to in one of our sessions in the beginning. I believe it was the first session. That a lot of the people in the sector are not that well trained. Kwame, do you still hold that view?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So there are poor levels of training, right? And then there's relatively low pay. This one is also very common knowledge. Kwame has complained about this as well. The mobility of labor between different employers And geographically, it's also very common. Like I said, even in Ghana here, you realize that you don't see a worker here at a hospitality institution you frequent. And then the next time you see them, they are at a competitor's institution. They have changed jobs, right? In another part of the world, you realize that employees in this sector would usually move from geographic location to geographic location, sometimes within the same organization, just moving from different, from branch to branch. Hence the mobility of labor between different employers and geographically. And then one significant factor in this industry is also the issue of working patterns involving working at nights and on weekends. So you realize that people have to run shifts to be able to ensure that they can be able to deliver the nature of service that is required in the sector. So 1 week, someone may be on night duty. The next week, they may be on weekend duty. The following week, they may be on morning duty, and so on and so forth, depending on the nature of the scheduling and the roster that is drawn up in the organization for these purposes. However, in some sectors, in other parts of the world, we can also talk about the importance of volunteer workforce, especially when it comes to events, right? So for instance, during the Olympic Games, particularly the one that was held in the United Kingdom, there were a huge number of volunteers that were needed to be able to ensure that the games came off without a hitch. So we realized that volunteer workforce usually comes in particularly for events and large events for that matter, because these are usually one-off events that take place and there is the need sometimes for extra hands to be able to ensure that the events are executed without a hitch. So sometimes without the resources to be able to pay everybody a particular salary or stipend, they would go in for volunteers who perhaps may be people who are interested in learning about the dealings in the sector or just want to offer their services to while away time. And these are all characteristic of employment and working conditions in the sector. Now, why is this information important? It is important because this is a direct influence on the nature of strategy formulation in the sector, such that strategic thinkers and decision makers in the sector must always take these factors into consideration when they are planning for their human resources and how that particular resource can contribute towards their journey to achieving a sustainable competitive advantage in the sector. So in terms of strategy, for instance, if the strategic decision maker has identified poor levels of training, in terms of strategy, it will have specific implications because when deciding how to allocate the firm's resources, there may be the need for some resources to be set aside to train staff. And given that there are various levels of staff, each of whom have different levels of interaction with the customer, the level of interaction with the customer must be clearly depicted in the nature of training that is offered. However, currently that is not the case. You realize that most of the training expenditure is done on those who are on the higher levels of the hierarchy than those at the base of the hierarchy. True or false? I mean, true or false? Just
it's true.
So they'll rather train the manager and then the frontline staff who are the first point of call with the customer in creating the experience is the one that is the last to be considered when there's some training opportunity. This thing has always not made sense to me and it still doesn't make sense. So like
it's I mentioned, leadership failure.
Leadership failure. Thank you, Pami.
Yes.
So please, when you go back, go and educate them to start thinking strategically. Mercedes, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, everybody. so I don't know, but I'm just a bit surprised that when it comes to the H&T industry, this is happening because it's vice versa. I mean, should I say at other places? So why is it that H&T it's the opposite. I just want to understand why. Maybe Kwame may have an answer for me. I think this one is for all of us.
Because sure. Let's brainstorm.
Because I'm thinking in my office. In fact, let me just share a little experience. I moved from KPMG to PwC. And when I was at KPMG, it was a bit like that. I realized most of the trainings that people have to go outside for is the managers who go. Once in a while, then they'll just chip in one, associate or senior associate to go. But when I went to PwC, and then in about 3 months, I saw this email that had to do with training in South Africa. And because I'm coming from KPMG and I know that place, they usually take
the senior.
So I saw the mail and I ignored it.
Yeah.
So I was there, so then my director came and she was like, have I seen this mail? And that he's waiting for my response. I mean, I was supposed to complete the form, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh, am I passed? He said, yes. So there and then I realized that, are changing, or maybe their way of doing things is a bit different.
Exactly.
So I went with another colleague who is also, he's also a deputy manager, and then my director. So we were three. And I went for the training and I realized that it was very, very good. And we came back and we shared a bit of what we had learned with those two are juniors.
Yeah.
So for me, I think some of these things, like you're saying, they need to train not just those at the top. Because when you look at, sometimes those at the top, they don't even come into contact when it comes to working with the clients. It's us, as the new people who go on the work. So, in fact, I must say that, where I work, a training just last week, for about 3 days, we were in training.
Yeah.
3 solid days, full days, Tuesday to Thursday. And somebody would be like, but you have work. Yes, as I say, but you also need to upskill ourselves. And
exactly, to continue delivering superior value.
In this era of data analytics, right now you realize that most of our data are voluminous.
Yeah.
So we had training, and they didn't just pick, they didn't say they are doing it for money, but they did it for us, and everybody knew. Yeah. And it was very helpful. So maybe Kwame, I think now you can come in and then let us know why.
Yeah.
The managers, because they don't meet, half of them don't even meet the customers. So
exactly.
Why? So is it because of maybe per DM or as in what is it? I just don't get it.
Thank you for that, Mercedes. Kwame, please go ahead.
First of all, Doc, for my observation, I think that it's the bus stops with our stakeholders, they do not have a lot of insight when it comes to the industry, especially with regards to hospitality and tourism.
I agree.
A lot of people do not have real knowledge in the field. I always call it Frefre Kobo. They call a few people and say, you come and do this. Come and man this. I talk with my colleague, Gloria Mott. I think she'll share her knowledge and her experience quite recently.
Yeah.
We realize that a lot of people come because they're falling out of school. So and they are looking for jobs.
Yeah.
So a hospitality owner says, okay, you come and be here. And he thinks that because you will be able to learn on the job, you do not need any formal training. And this, as a result, even if you look at the various situations, how many training organizations do we have? Organizations train in the field? We quite recently joined the hospitality and tourism network. We have an association now, and we discuss all these things there. But you ask me, how deep have we gone into this? Is there any proper formulation towards training and steering a certain affairs that will take us higher? We still talk about each day and go. Let me quickly chip in the issue of, I think you mentioned staff turnover, and you talked about the fact that you realize that today you see them probably in one hotel.
Yeah, then the next month they are in the other hotel.
Yes. First of all, I think it's with attitude and then salary.
Yeah.
You mentioned that salary is
back to the low pay.
the pay is not good, but mm-hmm. the attitude, because we lack training. There are ethics when it comes to our industry, especially with hospitality and tourism. The yeah. ethics, do we abide by those ethics? We don't abide by them. So
they are ethics, so, Kwame.
Absolutely. I mean, we don't know there are. Yeah. And so we just go out and do whatever we want to do. And we go home like that. So for me, I think with my observation, I'll say that is because stakeholders do not have deep knowledge in the industry, and they are not ready to spend. That's yeah. another thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you very much, Kwame. And thank you, Mercedes, for bringing this up. So right now, one of the main aims here, as part of what the take home from this call should be, is that at the level of strategic thinking, when it comes to human resources, these are some of the strategic decisions that have to be made. Improve the level of training of these staff, given that they are the first point of call. And perhaps the level of motivation with regard to the pay must be also looked at to be able to help with this level of high turnover, both geographically and between different employers, right? So these are just a few things we need to consider, but we realize that these are all pertinent issues that directly affect the bottom line of firms in the sector. And if we say we are strategists in the sector, these are some of the core things we need to focus on when we are strategizing for human resources in the sector. So in terms of the characteristics we identified above, we have established that these are challenges that we are still facing in the sector to date. So if you are a manager in the sector, you need to formulate specific tactics to handle each and every one of these challenges so that they do not become the Achilles heel of your organization and lead to your demise, given that the human resource, like we mentioned, is a key ingredient or critical success factor in the success of any organization in this sector, right? So for instance, the relatively high levels of staff turnover in many cases can become something particularly problematic, especially where you have staff that have been working with you for some time and have generated some level of rapport with a lot of your regular guests. Because like I said, I go to some of these hotels and I'm looking out for a particular staff member because we have some kind of rapport with the person and we are used to being served by this person. Then the next thing we know, the person is working with another employer. These can lead to high costs because this particular customer can decide, okay, I have so much rapport with this person that wherever this person has moved to, I want to move as well because I trust this person to serve me because they know my needs. Right? So high levels of staff turnover, for instance, could lead to high costs relating to, for example, additional recruitment activities, which may not always solve the problem of the high staff turnover. Because like I mentioned, you may recruit additional employees or recruit new employees to replace the staff that have left. However, in the event that this staff that has left has been there for some time, been in some key positions, and develop some kind of rapport and trust between themselves and certain key clientele of this hotel, there is the tendency that this staff member that is leaving is going with those clientele. And it happens a lot. Which, like we mentioned, can contribute to a significant cost to the organization. In this case, the loss of some major clients if the organization does not take care. It could also lead to higher costs relating to wasted training and development, especially where the firm has invested a lot in training this particular individual. So like Mercedes is saying, PwC is spending so much money training here. Then all of a sudden, Mercedes leaves with all the skills and training she has acquired. That is a significant cost to the organization because the training that they are investing in here, they are seeing as something they can benefit from into the long term. So if Mercedes doesn't stay with the organization into the long term, it's their loss. Similarly, when staff keep going and coming, firms find it difficult to keep up with training all these new staff that are coming in and getting them to become abreast of the nature of the organization, its culture, and how it goes about delivering its services. So this high turnover could also lead to cost in relation to difficulty in maintaining quality standards. Because every day you have a new person coming on the job who does not really know the ropes, who is not really fully trained like that employee that you lost. And therefore it will be difficult for you to maintain quality standards. So as a manager, thinking strategically, you need to be able to do your best to ensure that you do not go ahead to incur all these costs that we have talked about, which are a direct result of staff turnover. So if the staff are leaving and you are a strategic thinker, the first question you need to ask yourself is, why are they leaving? And I can count a handful of organizations in Ghana here who do exit interviews for staff that are leaving their organization. Have you experienced an exit interview before? Mercedes, when you were leaving KPMG, did they conduct an exit interview on you?
No, please, they didn't.
Okay. So I'm sure today they don't even know why you left.
Exactly.
See?
I have experienced that, but it wasn't formal. When I say formal, it wasn't
documented for records.
Exactly. I don't think so. I mean,
yeah, we can say it was not even done at all.
Absolutely.
I mean, yeah. Right. But this is a very important thing, especially when it comes to strategy, because information from these exit interviews can serve as the starting point for determining a lot of issues or problems that the staff are facing. And what they deem, yes, Kwame.
An intervention. Please. One thing I've realized is that when it comes to our industry and our field, it's like we are in a hurry to go. First of all, because the industry is capital intensive.
Yeah.
You're putting a lot. Mm-hmm. So you want to recoup, and in Visa, so recouping takes over a decade. It takes a very long time. So now they are looking at, management is looking at how best. Their focus is on generating revenue, making profit. And so they do not want to spend on the human resource. And when you even look at the kind of human resource that at the top, that is higher, it needs lot to be done. You see, we don't even go for the best. I can tell you about a few, I can mention few hotels. For restaurants, I don't think that they have too much when it comes to hotels, they hire people of not higher class.
Yeah,
with regards to knowledge in, yeah. Even when it comes to HR, I can tell you, just a few hotels have HR department, properly set up HR department.
Exactly.
Where even they have, there are people who have very basic knowledge in the field and do not have in-depth knowledge. So they are bringing in people who do not have requisite knowledge with regards to training when it comes to the industry.
Which is a
so
major
at the problem. End of the day, exactly. So at the end of the day, what are we churning out? And so you realize that what you are giving to the staff is nothing to write home about. And the staff keeps putting up a very rough attitude, which reflects in the operation of the facility or the job in general. At the end of the day, I mean, you have a very discerning guest come and says no. And the guest keeps changing. It says, no, I don't like this. I don't like the way I'm welcome. I don't like this.
Yeah.
So it goes on and on and on and on. So at the end of the day, the industry becomes so bad.
Yeah. And I think it is high time that the industry begins to realize the integral role that the human resource component plays in the sector. because it's primarily about service delivery and the creation of experiences by these people delivering the service. And when it comes to service delivery, one key characteristic is the inseparable nature of the person delivering the service from the service that they are delivering. So if the person delivering the service is bad, automatically the service that is being delivered will also be bad. And whatever experience is created out of that encounter involving that service provider will also ultimately be bad, just like Kwame is saying. So if we don't take anything at all from this, it's the only thing we need to appreciate is the fact that the human resource component plays a key role. And it is high time managers, entrepreneurs, and owners in this sector start paying close attention to the human resource element and the role that it plays, and start paying it the due that it deserves. Otherwise, they are on a crashing course. So Kwame, thank you for that submission. Very well said.
Hello.
Yes, Jemima, please go ahead.
I always also would fault regulators in the industry as to expectations and their own indexing measuring. Quality of staff or service that is being delivered to the public. So if they have their own baseline, and expectations of what should be the various categories, maybe 5-star, 4-star, whatever star you have, I think it will also be helpful and challenge the service providers to do more.
Very well said, Jemima, and that's another problem I have with this sector. The regulators in the sector are not up and doing. They are not very active.
Dog, please. I'm sorry, but I have to keep intervening.
Go ahead.
In fact, I appreciate what Jemima is saying. But Jemima, do you know where that issue, why we are having that? Because the regulator is even not it doesn't know what goes into regulation. We have just a few people with regulation knowledge when it comes to our industry.
Mm-hmm.
Just a few people, and these people are not trained. Mm-hmm. When you go to our tourism authority, okay, when you go there, those who come around do inspections, those who should hold us to account, don't even know what it takes to holding people account.
Thank you.
And so they come and they say, okay, let's check this, let's check that, let's check. It is just for, let me just cite an example. It is only this year that I saw a new team come around to do inspection, to find out why some workers are in name tags, others are not in name tags. Over the years, especially in the last half a decade, in the last 5 years,
mm-hmm.
everybody comes in and raises a bed, oh, and the bed is dirty. Okay, nobody will ask you, why are you not in name tags? Why is it that they only come to the back room, what we call the kitchen, and say, okay, the kitchen is dirty. And then say, okay, but they don't check basic things and tell you, okay, this is the way we go about this. This is the standard now, the world standard. And we don't refer to the world standard.
At all.
We're always referring to the local standard. Oh, when you go to maybe so-so-and-so a restaurant, so-so-and-so hotel, this is the way they do it in Asylum Down. Okay, so where are we going? So the regulator himself or itself has a problem.
Exactly.
The regulator is not adhere or it's not looking at new standard or world standard. So it's just the normal merry-go-round. Every
the
year,
minimum.
Let's just the way we do it. That's what I think. For me, sitting at and doing what I'm doing and looking at what is going on. This is what I can say.
Yeah. And I share similar sentiments. I don't think the regulator is on top of their game. I don't think they are up to the task. And it is allowing the sector to slowly deteriorate because anything flies. Like Kwame said, you just look at the bare minimum, right? And Jemima rightly mentioned, until the regulators sit up and start doing their jobs, as is required by international standard, because there's a global tourism authority which has standards for all these things. They have templates for assessing all these various aspects of service delivery in the hospitality and tourism sector. So if these international standards are not being adhered to, Gloria, please go ahead.
Okay, madam, please, what I want to talk about is, it's not about the regulators. The regulators have a limited, or let me say, they are limited to what they are expected to do. So I think when I use South Africa as example, their regulators are not under the Ghana, they are not under the tourism board. It's a private entity. So if Ghana could do that, and they know that they are responsible for this in the hotel industry, then I think the industry will grow more. But if it's still under the Ghana Tourism Authority, and they have a limited, they are limited to just some aspects of the industry, then I think the industry will not grow. For example, where I'm working, the boss can tell you that this thing, they are allowed to do it this way. Ghana Tourism Authority have not given them any regulation on this. They are not supposed to. So you see, you realize that we don't have any fixed regulation governing the industry.
Yeah.
So with that, anything at all happens. Anybody can stand up, open a hotel because they have the money, and then treat employees anyhow they want to, because we don't have the rules to govern the industry.
Very well put, Gloria. Kwame, please come back in. Yeah. Thank you for that submission, Gloria. Kwame, please go ahead.
Okay, so what I want to tell Gloria is that, you see, Gloria, in as much as we might not have a lot of laws, the basic ones that are there can take us along. The regulator should be up and doing. The regulator should make sure that he puts the strict basic measures that are there. He should put it in place. The regulator should put it in place. He should make sure that when you come around and people are supposed to be in their name tags, they should be in their name tags. What are they loyal? Is there any loyalty when it comes to service delivery? Is there loyalty? The regulator must insist that for you, and they should also organize trainings. You ask me, there is no law backing the fact that the regulator should insist that, but this is your industry. For God's sake, this is your industry. You don't want to wait for a law for the industry to grow. If we're all waiting for a law, there are so many laws that are not in place, but we need to move an industry forward. Mm-hmm. So whilst we look at regulation also, we should also look at the fact that new laws have to be enacted. But you see, just like we always say in Ghana, the laws are there.
Yeah.
The regulator must insist in making sure that things work.
That's very true. Right. So in several aspects, you are all right. It's about being able to know what the requirements of the law are and having astute institutions put in place to be able to ensure that these laws are followed to the letter, be it public sector or private sector. And in Ghana here, like Gloria is saying, perhaps if it was the regulatory aspect was decoupled from the Ghana Tourism Authority, perhaps it will help them to do a better job, right? But these are all strategic options that are available. Until we actually make a move and start pursuing some of these strategic options, we will not know the possible outcomes of whether or not it will help us solve the current problems that we are facing, right? So we need leaders with this strategic mindset to start making the decisions that have to be made to set us on the path towards solving these problems. Otherwise, the sector is heading nowhere fast, right? So in such circumstances, the challenge for managers, right, is to recruit and train talented staff, like we said, take actions to motivate these employees, and try and ensure that there's an appropriate work-life balance, because most people leave certain jobs not necessarily because they feel underpaid or they are not motivated, but sometimes it's about their inability to achieve that work-life balance in the sector. Given that a number of them are females, and we know that even in our culture, females struggle a lot when it comes to work-life balance. So as a strategic thinking manager, knowing how many females you have on your staff, Your strategic thinking should involve putting in place specific policies to cater to the work balance, work-life balance needs of these particular type of employees. This should also be considered in the drawing up of schedules, given that we know that work in the sector has to do with during the daytime, evenings, and weekends, which again has the tendency to upset the work-life balance of this particular gender we are talking about, being females. Right? So these are all strategic decisions that need to be made and will directly contribute to the organization's bottom line if they are able to strike a good balance among these. So knowing what we know, how can employers pay attention to all these challenges we have talked about in the unique circumstances in the sector to make sure that employees are well motivated and are good at doing their jobs to ensure that they achieve the outcomes that the organization is expecting them to contribute towards achieving? The first way this can be achieved is through job enlargement, right? And job enlargement is the means by which employees' jobs are made more worthwhile and interesting. So in some parts of the world, job enlargement could include giving an employee additional tasks of a varied nature. So not necessarily keeping them at the same place all the time, but moving them around to ensure that they keep working in different scenarios and circumstances that will improve upon their level of experience and expose them to different service experience scenarios or service encounters from which they can learn valuable lessons that they can apply on the job. Because you realize that usually when employees do the same job over and over and over again, they get bored. And in most instances, it affects the quality of their output because they are bored and tired of doing the same thing over and over. So in addition to helping them gain additional experience to be able to apply in other aspects of the job, giving them a wider variety of tasks will also help to keep them excited so that they can be able to be more alert and more motivated and driven when it comes to the performance of their tasks and duties at the workplace. So job enlargement is a good means of achieving this. Another means by which managers can achieve this is through job rotation. So by rotating jobs, making sure that employees are able to gain additional knowledge and skills about different roles and positions in the organization. So in addition to giving them a wider variety of tasks, they can also be placed in different roles. So if today someone is in the back office, helping in the accounts department, managing the books, it will be nice to rotate their job and move them perhaps to the front desk or to the business center, which a lot of hotels have, to be able to experience having to deal with that kind of customer who needs the services in these different job roles, right? And by doing this, just like through job enlargement, knowledge and skills are gained, right? And that way, one person cannot be stuck doing mundane tasks that they will become bored with and will have the opportunity to be able to try out other tasks that perhaps they may find more challenging and more interesting. And that way, the organization can also be able to determine who is the best fit for which task. Because until you can observe employees on the job as they discharge their duties, sometimes it's very difficult to be able to tell how well or how badly they will perform in a particular job role. So I hope that makes sense.
So, yes.
So job rotation helps with this a lot. That way you can be able to find the best fit for the best jobs in the organization. Now, another means to be able to achieve this is also through job enrichment, right? Some employers are not fond of giving employees autonomy or perhaps semi-autonomy to be able to discharge their duties at their discretion. The saying, to whom much is given, much is expected, is a direct representation of this issue of job enrichment. Because by human nature, when employees or human beings or individuals are trusted with high levels of responsibility, most of the time, they are able to rise to the occasion. So through job enrichment, managers should be able to give employees some level of discretion or empowerment to make certain decisions on the job as they encounter customers in service delivery. Because in the event that an employee always has to revert back to their superior to even solve menial tasks or solve basic problems that come up on a daily basis, that particular employee will not be motivated to even try their best or to even improvise, or to even be innovative when it comes to the job. Because hey, everything will be referred back to the supervisor. So why bother? Yes, I hope that makes sense.
Yes, though.
Yeah. So you should be able to give your employees some level of discretion to be able to prove themselves on the job. And once they are given that level of discretion, like I said, based on human nature, it serves as some kind of challenge to which a lot of individuals will gladly ascribe, because they would see it as a chance to prove themselves and get the chance of being appreciated for the efforts that they put in. So job enrichment is very important when it comes to the human resource aspects of the hospitality and tourism sector. We can also talk about job sharing, right? And this is where employees' jobs are shared between two or more employees, so that the responsibilities and the burdens of performing specific tasks in the organization are shared. That way, in the event that one staff member is not available, there is always an alternate staff member that is equally qualified and experienced to take over the job. And this helps a lot where we are experiencing high turnover, as is evident in this sector. Because if you have more than one staff that are well trained and capable of handling a particular task, in the event that one of them leaves, there is always a backup that is going to hold the fort and ensure that there are no abrupt breaks in service delivery. So these four means are some of the main ways by which strategic decision makers in organizations can be able to prepare for and handle some of the challenges that come up with regard to employees in the hospitality and tourism sector, and being able to ensure that they adequately and appropriately address the challenges that we have identified in the beginning of the session to ensure that the bottom line is achieved. So with that, let's move into managing the customer employee encounter, or in this case, the guest employee encounter. Like I mentioned earlier, the employees are a key element in creating customer experience, which is created through the process of what we refer to as the guest or customer employee encounter. And given that service delivery in the hospitality and tourism sector is purchased or delivered and consumed at the same time, the customer and the employee are both actors that cannot be separated from the service delivery and consumption process, right? And because of that, the guest employee encounter is one of the most difficult, even though it is the most important task for managers in the hospitality and tourism sector to manage. Because like we said, experiences are created through these encounters. However, a key component of these encounters are employees, which are the human resource. And if all these significant challenges are being faced with the human resource, then we know for a fact that definitely it will be very difficult to manage the guest employee encounter to be able to achieve the best outcomes, particularly if we have not taken significant strides to address all these challenges that we have identified beforehand and how they affect the employee, who is a key component in this particular encounter that we are talking about. So in fast-moving markets, especially in service industries like the hospitality and tourism sector, which we know are relatively labor intensive, to be able to ensure that the guest employee or the customer employee encounter goes off without a hitch, we rely mainly on one, the ability and knowledge of the people that are involved in this encounter. Chief among these being the employees, and usually dominated by the frontline employees who are usually the first point of interaction between the institution and the customer. Now, aside the ability and knowledge of the people, another thing that contributes significantly to the success of this encounter is the ability of people to learn. Because in dealing with customers day in, day out, I think those who work in the hospitality industry, you will bear with me that there is not a shortage of new experiences. As the days go by, you encounter certain customers in certain service encounters, and you're like, in all my years of working in this sector, I have not gone through such an experience before. And I'm sure if you ask people like Kwame and Gloria, they have plenty outrageous stories like that relating to guest employee encounters. True or false?
True, dog.
Yeah. So the ability to learn is very important, because with all these unique experiences that you encounter come specific learning opportunities, which if you are able to gain specific lessons from, you can carry forward to subsequent service encounters where you will encounter guests of a similar nature and may have to apply some of the lessons learned from this previous encounter to ensure that that particular encounter ends on a better note than the previous one. Likewise, the ability to adapt to change is also another success factor when it comes to the guest employee encounter. Because you will realize that customers evolve. And because of that, a particular customer that you knew very well could come in one day with a whole new different set of experiences. And because of that, as an employee in the sector, you cannot become comfortable and think that you know all that there is to know. And think that the status quo that you are currently experiencing is what is going to be dominant moving forward. Because the industry continues to evolve. Likewise, the nature of customers that are in the industry. That is why you find out that a lot of institutions that were hitherto hot spots in the industry over time have just died out. And you can see a new crop of institutions coming up. Even with the traditional institutions that we have known for many years, there have been various levels of change and evolution that can be observed with them. For instance, the Labadi Beach Hotel that we knew previously about 10 years ago, it's not the same Labadi Beach Hotel that we have now. Novotel Hotel that we knew before, right now no longer exists, isn't it? What's the new name?
Accra City.
So in this industry, we realize that change is constant. And therefore, as an employee in this sector, the only way you can be able to guarantee success is to have the ability to adapt to these changes. Because whether you like it or not, these changes are happening, and they're happening fast. So if you are able to adhere to these three criteria we have given and build yourself to achieve the ability and knowledge of the industry and the people you are serving, as well as the ability to learn and the ability to adapt to change, then as a human resource in this sector, you are primed to be able to contribute to a sustainable competitive advantage for your organization. Because these are success factors that can help you to be able to ensure that every guest employee encounter results in a desired outcome, particularly a satisfied customer or a delighted customer whose expectations have been exceeded. So in managing the guest employee encounter, the proof of service quality is in the flawless performance of these services. So if it is a person opening the door for the customer to enter, it should be performed flawlessly. If it is the person who is welcoming the guests and checking them in, it should be performed flawlessly. In that, every task that any employee is performing, they should be able to perform it flawlessly, regardless of how menial it is. And in Ghana's hospitality sector, even the people who are just supposed to say hello, welcome to so-so and so, sometimes are unable to even do that right. And it beats my imagination that you're just paid to stand at the front door and smile and say hello, welcome. And even that, you cannot do.
Doc, sometimes it's not their fault.
No.
The part is that they don't give them the treatment they have to give to them.
Gloria, what treatment?
The directors
are Gloria, not to no. Make... Gloria, no, 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 no.
Yeah, that's the fact. When the motivation is not there, don't expect the employee to give your guest that experience.
Oh,
Doc. I will disagree somehow with Gloria.
Yeah.
I will share my personal experience.
Please go ahead.
I joined my where I used to be as a young marketing officer.
Yeah.
And 6 months into been working there, I hadn't brought anything. Fortunately, my employer was very patient with me, and sales with regards to hospitality or hotel is difficult.
Yeah.
So one day I was fortunate to have Produce Buying Company, PBC.
Mm-hmm.
I appealed to them, and they came. They came, they used our outfit for the very first time. And I wasn't being paid well, but I was determined to make a mark.
Yeah.
You know, by the time whilst I was there, they used our outfit for 4 years. And by the time I wanted to leave, they had given me a job with their new hotel called Golden Bean.
Yeah.
And I was very fortunate to have a rapport with management, the chief executive, the HR. I was able to walk into any of them's office anyhow, any day, as a result of the way I conducted myself with them. Let me recount one particular event. One particular occasion, their public affairs director, who is in charge, who is in charge of hospitality, I mean, who has additional responsibility as for conferencing, on one of the occasions, made a mistake. They were supposed to have dinner on a particular day. He canceled the dinner.
Oh.
Now, the management, when it was time for dinner, I mean, they didn't inform us. She canceled it. But they came to, they held their meeting till evening, and they were asking for dinner. And you know what the public affairs manager says? Go and ask Kwame. Mm-hmm. So the management came at me, bashing me. But you know what I did? I kept quiet and received the flak.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, my management at my place also supported me by keeping quiet. They said, okay, it's our fault.
Yeah.
What happened? At the end of the day, we apologized, but it wasn't our fault.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it wasn't our fault. We put in place all the necessary measures. We accepted everything, everybody made everything. I just handled everything quietly. You know, the woman came, the public affairs director came to me and says, you have treated us well. We know it wasn't your fault. It was my fault. They gave me a very good package.
Yeah.
A very, very mouth-watering package.
Yeah.
In their new hotel. But I never went.
Mm-hmm.
I never went because I felt, I thought about other things. But the kind of package they gave me was good. But it was as a result of the way I conducted myself.
Exactly.
It's as a result of the way we conducted ourselves as management and as a hotel.
Uh-huh.
So what I'm trying to say is that sometimes employees shouldn't always be thinking about their pockets or mm-hmm. motivation. Sometimes you motivate ourselves. Me, mm-hmm. for instance, if I tell you what I'm getting in my job, I motivate myself.
Yeah.
Because I'm looking beyond where I am now.
Yeah.
So the employees should look beyond where they are now.
Yeah.
And also think about how best they can improve where they are.
Yeah.
And then propel themselves.
Yeah.
So that is what I have to share.
Very true. But you know, from Gloria's perspective too, like you mentioned earlier, Kwame, it's about the attitude. That those people like yourself who are very self-motivated, they will work hard. And you realize that what the organization is not even giving them, they get from guests who visit, out of the sheer gratitude of giving them that unique service experience, right? Just like you receive. But for some of them, their attitude is like, you're not giving me what I asked for. You're not giving me anything to motivate me. Pay me more and I'll smile more. So you're both justified. But the question is, how do we get all our employees to the level of Kwame to keep them self-motivated even when conditions are not ideal? And from Gloria's perspective, how do we get these people to change their attitudes, to realize that sometimes it is not about what you are getting, but where you expect to go to from where you currently are, which will determine how you carry yourself? So the managers have a great task ahead of them in terms of being able to train and motivate the employees that they hire to even be motivated when conditions are not ideal, to deliver the best kind of service in these guest employee encounters. So Gloria and Kwame, thank you both for sharing, right? However, this guest employee encounter, which is also referred to as the moment of truth, should be treated as a do or die affair. And it's called the moment of truth because it is considered as the organization's one best and last opportunity to leave a lasting impression on their customer. So it's about being able to train employees to appreciate the pertinent nature of this moment of truth and make sure that they do not miss that opportunity to leave a lasting impression with each and every encounter that they have with any customer, regardless of the circumstance. So when it comes to the moment of truth, it is very necessary for each employee to appreciate this one-off opportunity I'm talking about to leave a lasting impression. And that is because when it comes to service delivery in the tourism and hospitality sector, you realize that it is a fragmented experience where the customer does not interact with only one employee throughout the entire process. They interact with a certain number of employees throughout the process, each of whom have this moment of truth opportunity to give the customer an experience that will be memorable. So it's about helping employees to understand their role in the larger picture of creating this unique experience that will leave a lasting impression on the customer and contribute significantly towards building the firm's competitive advantage and improving the organizational performance into the long term. So for example, when it comes to the purchase of a typical holiday package, right? Or someone purchases a ticket to attend a concert. Given the fragmented nature of experiences in the hospitality and tourism sector, you realize that these two packages that we have just mentioned involve a wide range of activities that include different intermediaries, with customers experiencing different levels and forms of employees throughout these processes. So let's look at some of the intermediaries that we will be able to see in these two packages, including the holiday and the concert. So on the left side, we can see the package tour purchase, right? And the possible intermediaries that a customer could come across throughout the service encounter, culminating in different moments of truth, include the retail travel agent or the internet intermediary where they will buy their tickets to travel to the destination or where they will pay to be booked on that particular tourism package. Another point is where they would come into contact with the insurance company, where they will have to buy travel insurance
or buy some kind of insurance to guarantee their safety on the trip that they are making. They will also have to purchase ground transport to and from the airport and sometimes during their stay at the particular destination. They will also come into contact with airport handling agents, both at outbound and inbound airports, depending on where they are setting off from and where their destination is. They will also come across immigration and customs services at the airport for their destination that they are going to and the place that they are traveling from. Local ground transportation, we have already explained, which has to do with transportation that they will use while they are at their location or they when they get to their destination. Hotel and other accommodation is also a key part, where even in the hotel, they'll come across a number of other intermediaries and employees, including the concierge, the receptionists, the kitchen staff, the waiters and waitresses, among others. All of these are employees that they'll come into contact with through different service encounters, through which these institutions have an opportunity to leave a lasting impression on the customer. They will also come across companies selling goods and services at their destination, right? Sometimes straight from the duty-free at the airport. Then they may have emergency services at the destination, which is another intermediary. In the event that the tourist or the guest has some kind of emergency, they will come into contact with these emergency services, as well as other service providers, including restaurants, entertainment venues, event organizers, among others. These are all intermediaries that they will come into contact with. And the employees for each of these intermediaries have an opportunity during the service encounter to create some kind of lasting experience that will leave the customer satisfied. Now, on the other hand, when it comes to the purchase of a concert ticket, some of the intermediaries that the customer or the guest will come across include the ticketing agent or the concert promoter, or the internet intermediary where the tickets are being sold. They will also come into contact with the transportation to and from the venue. Whoever is in charge of that transport, they'll come into contact with. The catering staff of the venue or the providers in the locality, assuming some form of catering is provided at the event. They will also come into contact with sellers of merchandise, who would usually sell the merchandise of the artists that are performing during the concert. They will also come into contact with promoters of other concerts and events, which may be of interest to them as a result of purchasing a ticket for this particular event. Again, they may come into contact with hotels or other forms of accommodation, assuming it was required, given that some of these concerts could run late into the night and it may be impossible to return back to their point of origin. They may also come into contact with the artists and performers for whom these concerts are being organized. And once again, emergency and first aid services should be at the venue, which customers or clients or guests will come into contact with in the event that they have an emergency. So between the two, you realize that there are a different set of intermediaries and employees that the guests or the customers will come into contact with. So as managers, the onus falls on us to be able to sit down and look at the nature of the services that are being offered by our institution in the hospitality and tourism sector and try our best to break down the different service encounters throughout the journey of consuming this particular service and make sure that we have put in place the necessary strategies to guarantee that at every moment of truth, the customer is able to leave feeling satisfied and where possible, delighted based on their encounter with the employees of the institution during that particular service encounter. So that being said, when it comes to managing the guest employee encounter, particularly in tourism, the concept of the moment of truth can be applicable to what we refer to as the tourism system, which was developed by LIPA 1990. Now, this is the tourism system, and it basically refers to the system that captures the movement of a traveler from a point of origin to a particular destination, considering the interactions that they engage in with departing travelers and returning travelers within the transit region that they go through, moving from their point of origin to their destination. And it also considers the environmental factors that influence the successful movement of the traveler from their source of origin to their destination, including the human component, which we are discussing now, which is very, very key, the sociocultural components, economic components, technological components, physical components, political components, legal components, among others. All of these are environmental factors that contribute to the smooth flow of travelers to and from various destinations. Now, what we are saying is that along this tourism system, there are several opportunities and instances where we can observe service encounters that serve as the moment of truth for various firms and institutions in the hospitality and tourism sector. And because of that, BOM 1997 was able to produce a model of moments of truth, looking at the tourism system and the range of organizations that make up the tourism system. So BOM 1997 was basically able to decipher that in the tourism system, there are various opportunities for moments of truth and various service encounters. However, the most important thing he identified is that these service encounters do not carry the same weight, depending on the nature of customer that you are dealing with. So some elements of the service encounter may be more important to some customers than others. So for instance, like we were talking about a few moments ago, a customer may get to a hotel and the doorman will open the door and he will not smile, he will not be nice, he'll just open the door and that customer will walk through. Now, depending on the temperament of that customer and their expectations, that customer may not care that he was not smiled to. However, another customer may come and that smile may be all important to the point where, without having received that smile, welcoming them to the premises, every subsequent service encounter that they have will be shrouded in the pain and the disappointment of not receiving that smile as the first thing at the door when they entered the institution. But like I said, for another kind of customer, it will not be a big deal. And the inability to get a smile from the doorman will not subsequently predict how they react or feel about subsequent encounters during their experience with the service provider in the hospitality and tourism sector. So this is the tourism system. And the top of it is what BOM developed to explain the unequal weighting of the moment of truth along the length of the tourism system, considering all the processes and interactions that the customer goes through or that the tourists go through, moving from their point of origin or their region of origin to their destination, right? So you realize that there is none of these moments of truth that is considered of low importance. Because technically, every service that is delivered in the hospitality and tourism sector has a significant role to play in contributing towards overall customer satisfaction, which will lead to loyalty and ultimately influence the firm's bottom line. So you realize that the classification or the weighting of these various moments of truth starts from the mid-level of importance to the high level of importance. So for instance, when a tourist is moving from a point of origin to a particular destination, the first point of call per the diagram is contact with the tourist board, which is placed at mid-level importance. Why do you think contact with the tourist board is placed at mid-level importance? Just off the top of your head, why do you think contact with the tourist board is placed at the mid-level of importance?
Can I guess?
Yes, go ahead, Mercedes.
I'm thinking the tourist board they are the ones supposed to set some kind of rules and regulations. So
exactly.
which we are supposed to abide by. So mm-hmm. I think that's why they are placed there.
Good. But in terms of mid-level of importance, could it be because they do not have a significantly direct effect on the ability of the traveler or their decision to move from their point of origin to a destination? Can we say that?
Yes, please. That's why they're in the middle, yes.
Yeah.
Because I think it's the traveler that would decide whether he or she would go to a particular place.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right? Thank you, Mercedes. Whereas moving on from there, we see the travel agent who is at a high level of importance. And why is that? Why is the travel agent at a high level of importance?
Because, because he's the main access point.
Exactly.
So,
no, please go ahead.
Yes, so he's the main access point because it is through him or her that you will access your site or your wherever you're going. So they will show you what to do. They're going to show, they have direct contact to your site.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Okay. So, I mean,
that's why they are at a high level of importance.
Yeah.
Good one, Kwame. Now we move to the next level where we see the bureau, the change, and they are at a mid-level of importance. Can anyone give us a reason, perhaps, why the bureau, the change, is at a mid-level of importance? Gloria, do you want to try?
Madam, Doc, I wasn't following actually. I was doing something else. So if someone can come in and then later.
Okay, sure. So anyone want to bail Gloria out? Why would they place the bureau to change where they have? Mercedes, please go ahead.
I just need a bit of clarification. Is it those who change money?
Yeah, like the Forex Bureau.
Forex Bureau, okay. I think they'll be placed there because I mean, most travelers, when they travel, they have to change money mm-hmm. to the currency that the country that they are going to
use.
So I think that's why they are placed there.
Yeah. But they're not placed so high up because perhaps changing money is an option.
Yeah.
Given all the various electronic means of making payments these days.
And it's not everybody also that changes money.
Yeah.
We have different types of travelers. And so not all travelers. So if you put that bureau the change higher,
yeah,
and you don't want to look at others also who will not change.
That's true.
Money. Yeah.
That's true. Good. What about the airline check-in? It's placed quite high. Airline check-in.
This is because certainly you will have to check in when you are traveling. Come on.
Without you know that, you can't go anywhere.
Absolutely.
Good one.
Yeah.
And then we move a step ahead and they bring the airport shop, but they put it quite low, significantly low.
Again, it's not everybody who wants to shop. Maybe public travelers have done their shopping, and so it's not so keen. I mean, there are people who have done everything and will not want to come and say they are doing shopping at the airport.
That's true. I think that clearly explains why the airport shop is where it is. And then the airline is placed all the way up. I think this one is plain as day. Just like the airline check-in. I mean, if the airline says you can't fly with us, you are not going anywhere. And this happened to me some years back. I had a very nasty experience with British Airways. Since then, I've never taken British Airways again. So what happened was I was going to
I was going to Ireland and I wanted to go through Heathrow. But when I was buying the ticket, the travel agent failed to tell me that I needed a transit visa to go through Heathrow. And because previous trips I had made, I had gone through Frankfurt and Schiphol, I didn't think I needed a transit visa. So I didn't get one. So here I am, I show up on the day of the flight at the airport in airline check-in, in the queue, ready to check in. And then they check my flight details and they're like, okay, so you're transiting through Heathrow and you're going to Ireland. And then guess what happens? Who can guess what happened? This is a typical example of moment of truth service encounter. Guess what happened next?
Become bored?
Oh, they didn't even tell me I come bored. I mean, if I tell you what happened next, you will be so disgusted.
You were confused.
Gloria, if I was confused, I would have even asked around. Gloria, when I got to the check-in point, you know, the ladies who do the check-in, they were like, okay, there's an issue. Let me call the one on duty for the airline to come and see you. And the one on duty comes, takes my document and looks at it, and guess what he does next? He just ripped it into pieces. I said, you can't fly with us. What? Gloria, you said?
Maybe they are thinking it's fake.
No, he ripped it into pieces and said, you can't fly with us. Go and see your travel agent. And he wouldn't answer any other question. He just tore it up, walked off, and didn't answer any question. But knowing what I know, I insisted on getting some answers. So it was after pressing him up for several minutes before he says, okay, you don't have a transit visa, so you can't go through Heathrow. After he had done that. And that was a missed opportunity. That was a classic, terrible guest employee encounter, which to date has earned British Airways a terrible name in my book. I would never recommend them to anybody. I will never take any flight with them ever. And I'll always badmouth them.
Dog.
Yes, but
please do this for me because I'm asking this question because I just to be biased a bit to me. My dissertation is on service quality.
Okay. Yeah.
So which of the attributes will you assign to this?
Which attributes in terms of
which where will it service under service quality delivery? Can you attribute this to any of the elements?
Are you using the service quality dimension? Are you using SERVQUAL?
Yes, SERVQUAL. Yes, I'm using SERVQUAL.
Okay, so it affects physical evidence. Hey, no. SERVQUAL is not. SERVQUAL is tangibles, empathy.
Tangibles, empathy. Yes.
Reliability.
Reliability. Yes.
Responsiveness.
Yes.
And then there's
Does it affect any of them?
It affects reliability.
Okay.
Because I can't rely on British Airways to keep to my flight schedule and stuff. In the end, I had to take another airline. Luckily for me, another airline was going through Schiphol. KLM was going through Schiphol at the same time. So it affects reliability and responsiveness. They were not responsive. Taking my flight details and tearing it up is not being responsive. If you've been called, that there's a problem. That is not how you respond. And again, it violates empathy. Because when you are empathetic towards a customer and their plight, you don't think to aggravate their situation by making them more anxious, by tearing up their flight details. You empathize by saying, oh, sorry that this happened, but you can't fly with us. And then maybe proffer a few options. Isn't it, Kwame? Wouldn't that have been a better route? Yeah. So it violates reliability, violates responsiveness, violates empathy. I wouldn't say tangibles. There's a fifth one. Is it?
Assurance.
Yeah. It also violates assurance.
Assurance.
Because I was in no way assured that I would be okay in that scenario. And it was
so virtually almost everything on that.
Almost everything except the tangibles. Yeah.
Yeah.
And you realize that all the things I've mentioned, it was the duty of the employee
to deliver. Do you realize?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the duty of the employee to convince me about reliability, to be responsive to my needs, to be empathetic, and to give me assurance. And they failed on all these levels. So the entire service encounter was ruined because of my encounter with that employee. So it all boils down to the level of importance that the human resource has when it comes to guests or customer employee encounters in this particular sector. Because in this small example, we've just seen how one employee can mess everything up for a particular institution. So Kwame, I hope it helps with your longevity.
Thank you.
You're welcome, Kwame. Right? Beyond airlines, we can see the customs. And they are fairly high, even though they are not all the way up there. Because I've heard a few scary stories about how customs have ruined people's experiences at different airports. Most of them involve travelers coming from different destinations to Ghana through Kutuka. I'm told that the customs officers in Kutuka are a bit strict and difficult to deal with. Right, so I can understand why customs are up there. Gloria, you have an experience. What did they do to you? Gloria, what did they do to you?
Look, my first time traveling, yeah. And my visa, the ticket, everything was done for me from a friend.
Okay.
But the person was living outside, so okay. I just printed the information.
Yeah.
So when I got to custom, they realized that I'm a first time traveling, and they were asking me a lot of questions.
Mm-hmm.
I nearly missed my flight.
I'm sorry, Gloria. Sorry.
My mother had to come in.
And beg them. Oh.
And told them, she had to come in and prove to them that she's aware I was traveling and she's my mother. And, you know, just because they feel that young girls travel outside to... then later they get mistreated and all that. So
yeah. Sorry about that, Gloria. But thank you for sharing. So customs can make or unmake your travel experience, right? Depending on where you encounter them and under which circumstances. But next we can see that the hotel is the next one, and it's also up there because accommodation is very important. Where you lay your head, where you get to take your rest is very important because you get to keep all your valuables in this place while you are going around at your destination. And they are supposed to ensure your safety because usually this is where you will go to eat, to rest, and they are supposed to be able to ensure that your safety is guaranteed at all times. So I think that's why the hotel is high up there in terms of importance when it comes to the guest employee encounter. Then the craft shop. It's down there. And I think it goes back to explanations we've been giving for a number of the examples lately, that the craft shop is not necessarily the cup of tea of everybody. Not everyone is into crafts. So perhaps that is why the craft shop is placed where it is. And then finally, the tour operator representative. And I think we can all agree they are placed high up there because they are responsible for ensuring that the customer gets the best experience out of the tour that they have paid to be a part of. So whatever tour package they have paid to be a part of, it is the tour operator representative in the destination that is going to ensure that everything is discharged as has been agreed in the terms of the package for each tourist or guest. So in a nutshell, this is a BOM 1997's classification of some moments of truth in the tourism system. And depending on the sector you are considering in the particular package, I believe we can classify even more experiences and moments of truth as the traveler moves along the tourism system from their point of origin to their destination. So essentially, we are saying that when it comes to the human resource element in the hospitality and tourism sector, the onus falls on the manager to be able to link it successfully to business success through what we refer to as the virtuous circle.
And this virtuous circle looks at how managers can be able to put in place the necessary strategies and processes by implementing the strategies that they formulate with regard to developing the human resource and making sure they evolve and are developed into a high quality human resource, which will directly contribute to service quality, given that human resource or employees are an unrevocable or irrevocable aspect of the guest encounter or the customer experience, which predicts the level of service quality that is perceived by the customer. And based on the level of service quality that is perceived, the customer may end up either satisfied or dissatisfied, or in extreme cases, delighted based on how good the service was. And customer satisfaction will usually lead to loyalty, which can lead customers to engage in advocacy, positive word of mouth, which can ultimately drive in additional business from potential customers to the particular institution in the hospitality and tourism sector. And through this, the firm can be able to develop a competitive advantage, which they can sustain, ultimately resulting in business success. So like we have established throughout this session, the human resource element of the hospitality and tourism sector is a very key component. In fact, it's a critical success factor whose influence cannot be overemphasized. And therefore, managers have to strategically plan for this resource by formulating strategies and implementing these strategies to complete the elements of the virtuous circle in order to ensure that their human resources are of the quality standard that can ultimately lead them to achieve business success in the hospitality and tourism sector. And with that, we've come to the end of today's session. Before we call it a day, is there anything that you need clarification on, any question you want to ask before we sign off finally?
Oh, I just want you to go over the last line before this one.
Okay.
Linkages.
Yes, the virtual circle. Okay. Good. So the virtual circle we are saying has to do with being able to make sure that as a manager, you formulate and implement strategies to improve the quality of your human resource, to get them from the basic level that we talked about earlier, in an attempt to address the various challenges that human resources in the sector face, and then training them to be able to manage the guest employee encounter and make the most of moments of truth so that they can be able to deliver quality service to guests or customers, which is the green circle. Now, when customers are given quality service, it ultimately results in satisfaction because they are happy with what they received, and it's commensurate to the expectations they had coming into the consumption experience. Now, if customers are not happy with the quality of service that they receive, it results in what we refer to as dissatisfaction, where their expectations are not met, and therefore they are unhappy. However, in rare situations, service institutions, such as those in the hospitality and tourism sector, can sometimes exceed customers' expectations when they are delivering services by giving them over and above the level of quality that they expected, which can result in customer delight. Now, when a customer is satisfied or delighted, it leads them to become loyal because they can expect a certain level of quality when it comes to service delivery from this particular hospitality and tourism institution. So they will keep coming back to do business with this particular institution and ultimately become advocates for that particular institution, and through word of mouth, recommend that institution to other potential customers to also come and patronize the services of this institution, right? And that is in the purple circle. Now, once you continue to repeatedly satisfy customers and they stay loyal and they keep coming back to your business and they keep recommending your business to others, it contributes towards enhancing the success and performance of the organization, thereby leading them to have a competitive advantage over their competitors in the industry. And once the firm is able to achieve a competitive advantage that is sustained, they can be said to have obtained business success. Hence, the virtuous circle and the individual elements we have just explained. Jemima, does it make sense now?
Very well, thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, is there anything else? Awesome. So then we can call it a day.